Welcome to the Better Relationships Podcast with Dr. Dar Hawks, the relationship healer. On this podcast, Dr. Dar shares her insights that she has found to be essential for cultivating a healthy, happy, and harmonious relationship. Dr. Dar believes in helping you cultivate healthy relationship mindsets and behaviors, which will lead to communication techniques that create connection and empowers you to create self-sufficiency and safety within your relationship using human design and her relationship success framework. If you're curious where to begin to create better relationships and communication, Dr. Dar has created a quiz just for you at needs.drdarhawks.com. That's needs.drdarhawks.com. And now, here's Dr. Dar.
Welcome to episode 41 of the Better Relationships Podcast. Today, I'm talking about recovering from infidelity and what it looks like to repair a relationship after an affair. Allison and Frank have been married for 16 years and they have three children. One day, after taking their daughters to school, Allison spotted Frank in a coffee shop holding hands with another woman, whispering intimately, smiling and laughing, looking at each other in a flirtatious way, and then she saw him kiss her. She felt as though the ground was slipping away beneath her. How could this be happening? She felt her heart shatter into a million pieces. Her world came crashing down. Her relationship is her everything, she thought. Her partner is her rock, and rocks don't shatter into pieces. She wondered, what does she have that I don't have? Exact numbers about affairs are hard to come by, but there are some studies that reveal that half of married people in the U.S. will engage in some form of infidelity at some point during their relationship. To me, that's a very large number, but when you add in and consider how many couples that do split up, not necessarily because of infidelity, that is really on par with the rate of divorce. I haven't seen any pattern of whether it's the man or the woman who cheats most in my work with couples over the last two decades as a relationship, communication, and couples and marriage coach. But I have seen a pattern in the reasons people stray away from their primary relationship. Those reasons begin way before the affair starts, but because couples have the lack of awareness, or they avoid things, or they keep distracted, that's what keeps couples from paying attention to them and being aware of those patterns. Here are some of those reasons. Having an expectation that your relationship will stay in the googly eye honeymoon stage. Having a child thinking that's going to bring you closer to your partner or give you a common purpose or interest. Having no understanding or comprehension of each other's roles or career, much less supporting each other with them. Not listening or communicating well such that you understand each other. Not paying attention to each other's needs or supporting each other in getting them fulfilled. Having differences in political, social, religious, or career compatibility. Believing love is enough to have a healthy, happy relationship for the long term. Thinking family or friends can help you become a better partner. Having financial differences. Here's an example. You're a saver while your partner's a spender. Or you're bringing in an income to the relationship, but your partner has become couch-ridden after they lost their job. Not having discussions and making agreements about what infidelity means and the consequences of cheating behaviors before becoming a committed monogamous couple, and talking about things actively so that you both avoid those disastrous behaviors. Here are the various types of infidelity. There are three main categories of infidelity that women can experience. The first one is physical infidelity. This involves sexual contact with someone outside of your committed relationship. It can range from one-night stands to ongoing secretive affairs. The second one is emotional infidelity. This involves developing a deep emotional connection with someone outside of your relationship, oftentimes without any physical intimacy to start. Emotional intimacy can threaten your primary relationship just as much, if not more, than physical intimacy. Mental infidelity is the third one. This involves not connecting with your partner intellectually or being able to understand and relate to their career or aspirations, or having intellectual conversations about ideology or philosophy or beliefs that you both have and talking through them. The term work spouse refers to a coworker or someone in a similar career field who has a special relationship with bonds similar to those of a marriage. A work affair can be termed work spouse. And that's another form of infidelity that women can experience. Here's a breakdown of some specific types of infidelity women might experience, considering all four types. I said three before, but it's really four, including the career or work spouse infidelity. So here's a breakdown of some of those specific types of infidelity that women might experience. A one-night stand. It's a brief, unplanned sexual encounter outside a relationship. One-night stands can turn into one of these other types of infidelity, but oftentimes they're just that, a one-night stand. A romantic affair. It's a more developed relationship with emotional connection and potentially physical intimacy with someone outside of your relationship. Cyber infidelity. Developing an emotional connection with someone online or through porn, which potentially leads to sexting or explicit conversations. An emotional affair with a friend or coworker. That's a close platonic relationship that could cross boundaries but provides emotional intimacy typically reserved for a romantic partner. A vengeful affair, engaging in a physical or emotional relationship to get back at your partner for infidelity, emotional neglect, or having none of their attention because maybe they're focused on their career and traveling a lot or some other reason. A situational affair. This could be a one-time lapse in judgment due to factors like the opportunity presented itself, intoxication, or even emotional vulnerability in the moment. Having members of the opposite sex fill a role at the office that a spouse does at home, such as ensuring you ate lunch or your needs are taken care of in meetings, or being easy to communicate with all about things that are work-related. It's important for you to note that these are just some examples, and the specific reasons why women experience infidelity can vary greatly. Some couples might have different agreements about what constitutes cheating, like what is really emotional versus physical intimacy. Couples have different definitions of that. Couples have different definitions of what cheating is and is not. And so it's important that a couple discusses that early in their relationship, sets their boundaries and agreements around what cheating is and is not, and what is okay for the other to engage in versus what is not. Also, the impact of infidelity depends on your values and boundaries and that of your partner. They vary greatly. As a coach focused on helping women in struggling marriages, understanding these different types of infidelity is essential. It allows me to have open conversations with you, explore the root causes of your situation, and most importantly, navigate through your feelings, your pain, and uncover what you truly desire underneath all of that. Determining and building next steps and a path forward can feel impossible when you're in the middle of processing your partner's affair or your affair. But I do know together we can get there. The trauma of discovery. The way in which you find out your partner is cheating can make a big difference in how you react or respond. For example, if your child sees texts on their father's phone and tells you about it, that can be way more gut-wrenching than you finding out yourself, like Allison did. because the last thing you want is for your child to have to deal with the infidelity with you. If you see your partner at a cafe like Allison did, it's you having to process and deal with it, not your child. Your child may sense something is going on, but they don't know exactly what it is without being explicitly told. So you can process it on your own while ensuring your child is cared for. On the other hand, if your partner comes to you and tells you what's going on, it's not any less painful or traumatic, but it is a better way because your partner is taking accountability and responsibility for their actions. They're being honest with you rather than being found out. And together, you can navigate and deal with the consequences and fallout. Regardless of how you found out, you may very well be asking yourself these questions. What should I do if it happens in my relationship? How do I know if my relationship is worth saving? How can I repair such a catastrophic betrayal? Is recovering from this affair possible? How can I trust my partner again? Will I ever recover after my partner's affair? Will I stop remembering that they had an affair? Will I stop looking for evidence that they are being faithful? When infidelity creeps into your relationship, its presence can linger in the air long before the actual affair is discovered. While one of you can cope with suspicion, intense distrust, low self-esteem, and resentment, the other partner wrestles with guilt, fear of being caught, denial, anger, feelings of not being supported, or worse. When the affair is confirmed and brought into the open, it is a traumatic event for both partners, not just the one who is betrayed. For the person who discovers the affair, there is the agony of betrayal, being lied to, being cheated on, being embarrassed that this happened to you and how you could not have even seen it or been aware that it was going on. For the one having the affair, there's a sickening mixture of remorse and, believe it or not, relief. At least now the secrecy can end, which relieves some pressure. The first stage of healing. Before any talk of next steps for your relationship can occur, there must be some fundamental healing that needs to take place. Your partner has to be and arrive at a place where they can allow you to vent your feelings in a safe way with plenty of support for you. This can be extremely difficult for them to hear and may put them on the defensive and even attacking mode. You've got to learn how to vent in a constructive and not a destructive way, which is so hard to do because you're feeling betrayed. You're feeling like trust was shattered. You're feeling angry and resentful and even bitter. It's difficult to be constructive when you're feeling angry and unsafe and betrayed. Learning how to communicate constructively will, though, go a long way instead of lashing out at your partner. While it's natural to become angry, condescending, blaming, critical, or intensely disgusted, processing your emotions with a professional relationship coach and not your partner will help you get your mind organized while also validating your justified emotions. I'm not saying you can't share how you feel with your partner. I am saying that doing it in a calm, organized, carefully thought out, and planned manner is essential and can help you forward recovering from an affair, whether you choose to stay in the relationship or not. Initial emotional reactions could include telling your partner to end it or you're leaving, and you're going to tell their family all about it. Giving your partner ultimatums, talking to your friends and family who quickly jump to either support you, tell you to get a divorce, tell you to just suck it up, or they start alienating your partner. You could break down emotionally. You could lash out at your partner for anything or everything. You could question what you did wrong or ask what's wrong with you. You could also not look at what both of you are doing that affects the health and well-being of your relationship. And you could also ask lots of questions to learn more about the other woman so you can see what they have that you don't. You could want to know everything your partner is doing and where they're going, thinking that that will reassure and validate you or prove to you that your partner's being faithful again. You may not be able to see how you and your partner can get past this to create a better relationship. You could feel distraught because you caught something from your partner, like an STD, because they were cheating and not because they were not taking precautions with the other woman or with you. All those reactions are absolutely natural. But what you do with those reactions and how you respond and deal with your partner going forward matters for your own well-being and that of your child. Having an openness to listen, understand, and comprehend your partner's perspective will go a long way towards healing yourself and moving forward from the pain, as hard as it may be to do so. I'm not saying you have to agree with it. I'm just saying you have to be open to hear it and be ready to hear it, which is extremely difficult without getting professional support. The partner who is having the affair, on the other hand, needs to be clear on what they want. Do they want to stay with you and work on the relationship? Do they want to separate, but while in separation, working on themselves, do they want to date you or not? Or do they just want to walk away from you? As hard as it is to hear that, it's important that they get clear on that. They need to determine whether they will end the affair if it has not already. They need to inform their partner of when they ended the affair and, believe it or not, be ready to prove it repeatedly that they have ended it. If they have not ended the affair, they need to inform their partner of how and when they will end it and if they'll end it. They also will need to inform their partner of what they'll do daily to rebuild trust. They need to identify and communicate areas of their own self-growth. They need to be and demonstrate remorse and humility with a desire and follow through to create and have a better relationship with you, rather than denial or being defensive. They'll also need to be ready to give you choices as to what the next steps are and collaborating together with you on what that looks like as you put an action plan together and work your action plan every moment, every day. You may be faced with a partner who does not want to or is not ready to end the affair. If that's the case, I want you to know you're in control of what happens next, not your partner, even if it doesn't feel like it. You are empowered to inform your partner that continuing with the affair is a deal breaker and it ends your relationship with them immediately. You're empowered to determine whether or not you accept a timeline for when your partner will end it if they're not ready to do so now. You're empowered to tell them that you're not going to sleep with them while they're having an affair. You're also empowered to determine what will happen next. You're also in control to determine what will happen next. You are at choice here. Each of you can benefit from individual coaching. However, couples coaching is crucial in this process for healing to take place. Assessing the nature of your relationship after an affair. The discovery of an affair can highlight underlying issues that previously were threatening your relationship. You as a couple can then decide if your relationship is worth repairing. I feel that every relationship is worth repairing whether you stay together or not, because that provides the space for you both to arrive at a healed place instead of carrying forward the pain into your future as an individual. In coaching, Frank faced his feelings of resentment about Allison's long work hours, and Allison received support coping with her intense feelings of betrayal that dated back to her father's affair when she was a teenager. Like others who have discovered an affair, Allison got plenty of advice to leave her marriage and give up on her husband. It was an emotional, confusing time that shook the foundation of her whole life. Ultimately, the decision to leave the relationship or marriage is yours. Oftentimes, my clients put that power and control on their partner. There are 6 fundamental questions that can guide you if you've discovered your partner is having an affair. Has your partner or spouse taken responsibility and expressed remorse? And have you been able to receive that? I.e., do you believe your partner is taking responsibility and showing remorse? Number 2, Has your partner or spouse actually ended the affair, or are they in the process of doing so, and do you believe them? Are they willing to attend couples coaching? Are they willing to do their own self-growth and healing? Do you share the same values and goals for your future? Is this someone you can be joyful about spending the rest of your life with once again? Are you and your partner willing to mend the relationship, rebuild trust, and create a better relationship till death do you part? Conversely, here are some questions for you to contemplate while you're figuring out what's next for you and your relationship. What do you need from your partner that would rebuild your trust in them in the short term and long term? Initially, it's going to be daily, moment to moment. After that, it gets a little bit easier and your needs will shift. So you've got to be clear about what those are and actively assess them. Are you willing and open to hear your partner's perspectives, needs, feedback, and requirements so that you can build a better renewed relationship with them? Will you be open to listen and then find common ground? They're going to share some things with you about your relationship that maybe you didn't see early on. And you'll need to be in a place to not take it as blame or criticism, but simply something that happened along the way of your relationship and along the path when they chose and went and had an affair. Those things need to be resolved and they need to be talked about. You will also be sharing some things with your partner that they'll need to be open to listen to so that you both can resolve them and find common ground with them. Are you willing to attend couples coaching so that you can have a guided, supported conversation around difficult topics and resolve them? Do you have the same values and goals for your future? And is this someone you can be joyful about spending the rest of your life with? And right now, if you're in the midst of dealing with an affair, you may not be. But deep down inside, I believe that you do know whether you want to try and make it work or not. Repairing your relationship. Ultimately, Allison and Frank did decide to stay together, partly because of their three children, but mostly because they still loved each other. They realized that they both had engaged in relationship behaviors that really didn't support building a strong relationship, and having children put their focus on their children's lives and nurturing the relationship went on the back burner or was a lower priority. This process of repairing your relationship can be exhausting, but it's illuminating. And families who go through this type of trauma often come out with a much better relationship than ever and a deeper understanding of each other. And when couples go through that process, their children notice and see the active changes in behavior and communication between their parents, such that they start seeing you both becoming role models for a healthy, happy, and harmonious relationship, which then helps them build better relationships for themselves. How you deal with, recover, and rebuild your relationship from infidelity also has everything to do with your sovereign relationship need. Once you know what your sovereign relationship need is, a path forward for healing and a strategy for dealing with infidelity can be customized to your needs and that of your partners and your relationship. What works and heals you can be very different from what works and heals your partner. To create a healed relationship, you both may have different needs, and because of that, you both are going to have to support each other in different ways to rebuild trust and heal. Knowing your partner's and your primary sovereign relationship need can provide you with insights as to how that can happen for you and your partner and your relationship. I invite you to take the Sovereign Relationship Needs quiz by going to drdarhawks.com and clicking Relationship Needs Quiz in the top menu bar. Please have your partner do the same, and you will receive PDFs with detailed information on each of the sovereign relationship needs so that you can better understand each other's best perspectives from the lens of each other's sovereign relationship needs. For now, I'm going to share more about infidelity and the five sovereign relationship needs and how it shows up and affects the relationship. With the love and belonging sovereign relationship need, infidelity destroys emotional connection, so you feel unloved, rejected, or perhaps abandoned. With the freedom sovereign relationship need, infidelity restricts freedom by feeling trapped in a situation that you have no control over, or you may feel controlled because you don't think you can leave or end it, or that your partner chose to go and have this relationship, and so you have no control over that or over what your partner does or doesn't do. With the fun sovereign relationship need, infidelity is a fun and joy killer. After having an affair, you may struggle to enjoy spending time together. If your partner has the fun sovereign relationship need, having an affair brought some fun into their lives that they may not feel like they were having in the relationship with you. Rebuilding fun involves rediscovering shared interests while not focusing on the betrayal during quality time together, instead of scheduling separate times to work on that topic together. With the power sovereign relationship need, infidelity completely shifts the power dynamics between you. You may feel disempowered, question your role in decision-making and a path forward if your partner has cheated on you. You may relinquish control and power to your partner because of that. With the safety and survival relationship need, infidelity completely threatens your emotional, mental, and potentially even your physical safety. You may feel being abandoned. You may worry about your future safety and security. The sovereign relationship needs are a proven way and method to help couples resolve differences and come closer together by really understanding each other's needs. It also is a framework for improving communication with each other. Quite often, couples have different sovereign relationship needs, and unfortunately, we each speak and know our own sovereign relationship need really well, and so when we're communicating and interacting, we do so from our own sovereign relationship need instead of that of our partners. And so learning to build relationship skills that honor and respect your partner's sovereign relationship need and your partner doing that the same with your sovereign relationship need takes coaching and practice. Here's a summary of the healing steps that should be taken after you discover an affair. Number one, get support. Make sure you both have adequate professional support to individually express your feelings and needs. Even if you choose to leave the relationship, investing in professional relationship coaching support will help you move forward, heal, and help you understand your growth opportunities as well as prepare you for your next relationship should you dive into one in the near or far future, even if you don't think you're ever going to have one. Number two, getting to the root. Working separately as well as together with a professional couples relationship expert will help you look at the root causes of the affair. Doing so on your own or with your partner is extremely hard. You will also identify communication and behaviors that could have helped lead to the affair, and you'll learn how to transform them much quickly to build the health of your relationship and restore trust. Number three, getting together. Using the coaching process to move forward by communicating honestly and respectfully about whether you will stay together or move on is important. If you both choose to stay together, you'll learn to use the coaching process as a constructive way to help you both move forward and not stay stuck in the drama or trauma or pain. Getting better. Taking individual accountability for your self-growth and your contributions to the relationship, whether they were negative or positive or neutral, will help you define and demonstrate incremental improvements by working with your relationship coach. And you'll build relationship and communication skills that will draw you closer. If you suspect your partner is having an affair, or you've confirmed it, or you are contemplating having an affair or are having one, please contact me and let's create a healthy path for you so that you can reduce or perhaps even avoid trauma that results from an affair. You can do that by going to drdarhawks.com and clicking the contact button in the top menu. I look forward to hearing from you and seeing you in my next podcast.
Thank you for tuning in to the Better Relationships Podcast. We'd love to hear from you. Leave a quick review on iTunes. Subscribe to the Better Relationships Podcast on your favorite platform and share it with friends and family. Take the primary relationship needs quiz at needs.drdarhawks.com to discover how your core relationship needs influence your interactions with your partner. That's needs.drdarhawks.com. For any questions, comments, or topics you'd like covered on the show, feel free to DM Dr. Dar on Facebook at drdarhawks1, that's Dr. Dar Hawks 1, or on Instagram and Threads at dr.dar.hawks. Disclaimer: the advice in this podcast is not a substitute for the professional medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment provided by licensed medical or mental health professionals.